all of the academic advising and you have been responsible for all of the training for both the faculty advisors that come to University College as well as the professional advisors. And then we're also very in touch with Disability Student Services. Obviously, we work very closely with them. We have someone on my staff that has particular expertise in this area, and I would like for that expertise to be extended to all of us.
Great. Cool. Thank you. Why don't we keep going around the room, and then we'll introduce our speakers.
Great. I'm Ben Lovely. I do Sakai support here in the ITS group at URI. Feel free to come to me with any and all Sakai questions. And I'm here to learn specifically about how our learning management systems can better accommodate students with different learning needs.
I'm Austin Becker. I'm faculty in Marine Affairs.
Hi, I'm Brenda D'Amigo. My major role at CCRI is Program Director for Disability Services. Mm-hmm. And so we have coordinators on each of the four main campuses, and obviously we interact with faculty around these various issues.
Great. My name is Joshua Calkins. I am the Assistant Director for Faculty Development here in the for the Office for the Advanced of Teaching and Learning. Wow. Thank you.
Okay. And I'm Eric Calder. I'm Josh's partner in crime, also Assistant Director for Faculty Development out of ATL. We're really pleased to have Paul LaCava and Deb Ehrenberg here with us today. I think that it's really important that we'll be able to share this material more broadly. Obviously, we have almost 20 people who signed up and not quite as many here in the room. But I did want to, one of the things that's really important for us, I think, is to, every year we get contacts from a handful of faculty who've had an experience with a student who, at least most likely and often, they were clearly told was in the autism spectrum, but they only learned about it midway through or at the very end of a course. A set of negative things had happened, and as a result, the class climate may have been affected, or they felt like they had failed this student. It's usually a faculty member who's quite upset that they missed an opportunity, and so we wanted to provide them with some, they usually ask us for some training or support around this, but we realized that the true issue is that faculty need the support before this happens, and that's why we kind of want to make these materials as widely available as possible. And so we're really happy today to have Paul LaCava, who is Associate Professor for Special Education at Rhode Island College here, as well as Deb Ehrenberg, who is the Technical Assistance Facilitator at the Sherlock Center, which is also located at Rhode Island College. And we had heard about this fabulous series of workshops that have been set up at Rhode Island College and thought, can't we get people to come here and share with us this material? So we're really quite fortunate to have them here today, and we look forward to a lively discussion. Right. I'll hand off to Paul, I guess, who's the beginner here.
Thank you very much, Eric and Joshua, and we really appreciate that you came today, both those in person as well as our friends virtually. It's always great to see people come out and want to talk about autism, which is, for Deb and I, one of our favorite topics. So, for the first part of the presentation, I'm going to make some broad brushstrokes and kind of set the stage for Deb to talk about communication and behavior. Some of the most important characteristics of autism. And
I just gotta share the screen.
So we clearly know there are more individuals with autism at the collegiate level, without a doubt. And that coincides with the increase in prevalence of autism over the last, probably from the beginning to middle 1990s.
Oops. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
No worries. So, and that's especially so, like in the last 3 to 5 years, even at RIC, we've seen increases of numbers of students who have autism, and that from my readings, that's happening nationwide. And for a couple reasons, not only the increase in prevalence, but you gotta think, these kiddos back in the 90s were getting early intervention, many of them. And so their trajectories changed from what perhaps we traditionally thought was going to be an outcome for someone with autism, say back from the 50s, 60s, 70s. So not only early intervention, but a whole K through 12 programming of IEPs that got them the services they needed. And as we see, they are now entering college. And they have been in college, and there have been many people with autism to go to college over the last 100 years. And certainly there are professors who are on the spectrum who have expertise in their given area. So it's nothing new, it's just much, much more. So how do we support these students? How do we support all of us as faculty and staff at universities? So there's immense potential out there. But we have all these, especially the behavior and some issues that Deb's going to talk about, that are really critical to success. And how can we change some of these outcomes and statistics that we know? So please feel free to ask questions at any time. And also feel free to send email questions to Eric or Joshua. And then we can let the people who are going to speak next week know about those questions. If we can't answer them today, then perhaps they can address them more specifically. Okay? All right, so this first workshop today is Understanding Autism, especially looking at behavior and communication. Next week from, is that tomorrow? Yep. Strategies to support students in the classroom, and that's going to be led by Sue Constable from the Rhode Island Technical Assistance Project, as well as URI's own Dr. Adam Moore from the School of Education. So it's awesome that we have this collaboration of these three entities, and we have folks from CCRI here, and it really shows that how important it is for all of us to be working together, sharing resources, and meeting the needs of all stakeholders. So I wanted to start out. We want to start out with just a question to kind of gauge where you all are in terms of background in autism. First of all, in terms of your knowledge and understanding of the condition, raise of hands, how many people would say they have an advanced knowledge of autism? Okay. Anyone online say they have advanced? I think someone from the communication department said that's her area. That's okay. Anyone at the beginner level, or is it introductory, that they're just starting to learn? Okay. All right, so we kind of have a spread. Hi.
Hi.
Welcome.
I'm Pamela. I guess I'm with the Advanced
Services. Oh, great. Nice to meet you. Welcome. And you came in a little bit late, too. What's your name?
I'm Faye Boucher. I'm from engineering.
Great. Okay. And?
Rob Thompson from Marine Affairs.
Marine. Wonderful. Okay, so we have a nice diversity of departments and backgrounds. So the second question has to do with your experiences with students on campus. So would anyone want to share their experience or a situation or something that perhaps maybe that's why you're here today?
So Alex share an experience from a number of years ago where my training is as a sociologist, and I was teaching one of our majors courses called Sociological Theory. It involved reading lots of texts from the 1800s that were originally written in French and German. Most students struggled deeply with it. And we had this one student who always came to class super prepared. Any question I answered was the first to answer it. When other students would tend to answer, she would kind of, they tended to be much less on top of the material, and she tended to speak in a tone that made everyone feel like they were an idiot. And as a result, over the course of the semester, this tension became more and more obvious. And there were a number of other signs that kind of made it appear quite likely she was in the spectrum, and eventually, you know, it became clear that that was the case. But the classroom dynamic over the course of that semester got worse and worse because the students became increasingly willing to express their dislike for her. First, it was the body language, you know, they expected her to pick up, "We're annoyed with you." And they kept kind of elevating it to the point where they, you know, started to verbalize more what it was.
Oh, that's a terrific example. Anyone else want to share? Yes, Pam.
Well, I had a student a number of years ago that was, he was the son of a policeman who had, and this student had autism, but he's a big guy. He's completely compliant and completely a nice guy. And yet he had the verbal tone where it was, it sounded to a typical ear, it sounded aggressive. And so now the professor was getting more and more afraid of him. It was almost like I had to take it out of her class. She would, she was really afraid of him to the point where they were calling the police if he came back. Mm-hmm. And yet, from our perspective, he was completely compliant. He did whatever he was told to do. He did not intend to be aggressive sounding, but he knew that it was just the way he spoke, and it was hard to control.
Yeah, so that's
a major misunderstanding.
That really points out the misunderstanding on both sides.
Right.
So he didn't know how he was sounding and coming across and the impact that had on the classroom, as well as your situation, Eric. And then the other folks didn't get him. They didn't understand him.
Right. Can I ask folks just to speak up a little bit more? Because the folks online are having a hard time hearing us. So folks, just project a bit more. That's all. Thanks.
Okay. So I'm going to go off topic just a minute, because what both Eric and Pam just talked about, we had a young adult with autism speak to our class on just 2 days ago, and he talked about this very thing. He calls it perceived autism arrogance in the tone of voice, and he had that at once, and he didn't get it until someone shared with him how he sounded and how he came across. And so naturally he was very easily able to learn that, okay, I have to change some things. So that's a very interesting connection.
This is Yen. I would like to share an experience. Can you hear me?
Yes, great. Hi.
Hi. I have a student who would like to do some research related to autism. So I met her in my office. At the beginning, I feel like she was not comfortable, and later we figure out it's a light. It's a lighting in my office was disturbing her. So I turned the light off, and she feel much more comfortable. So I just feel like I need to understand the students more.
Oh, thank you for sharing that, Yen. I mean, it's something seemingly so simple, and yet can have dramatic impact on their ability to perform and be engaged. So we have some sensory things, some communication and behavior, and it's kind of a pattern that's starting to develop here. So anyone else want to share? Maybe one more, or we can go on, either way. Yes?
I have a student who would continually ask questions. And oftentimes they wouldn't be quite on point and just not make the class. So I had him start keeping track of how many questions he was asking during the class compared to how many questions other people were asking. I never asked him if he was on the spectrum or suggested that he do something that, but it was clear he wasn't sensitive to the other expectations of the class.
Okay, so I'm not sure if our folks online heard that, but Austin shared about how he had a student who asked many, many questions, often not necessarily on topic, and how he did a little strategy of having the student count to keep track of how many questions he did ask and then compare to the other students, and that was something that, did it help?
Yeah, it did.
It did? Good.
But once again, I didn't do any, like, I think you're on the spectrum or anything.
Mm-hmm.
You can have the same problem with people who have other issues anyway. So.
Exactly. Yeah, good point. Okay, so let's move on and just go over some basics. And I'm going to go quickly through these. If anyone has a question or would like further information, feel free to let us know. This is just kind of some very common info. So autism has been conceptualized in many different ways over the last half century. At first, obviously, we thought it was a psychogenic disorder and blamed parents, especially mothers, and said they couldn't develop relationships with their kids, and that's what caused the child to withdraw into themselves. Then in the 60s, it became more of a behavioral disorder and looked at it in that way. We've looked at it as a developmental disorder. But the phrase I like is neurodevelopmental, because it clearly shows that there's brain differences that are behind the characteristics we see in a variety of symptomologies. And clearly, as evidenced by some of the comments, the social communication area is one of the most important facets that we have to discuss. Now, in 2013, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual for Mental Disorders reclassified autism as a spectrum disorder. And even though we were using that term for quite some time, this codified it within the psychiatric, psychological universe, basically saying it's a spectrum disorder. It presents very differently from individual to individual, although there are some core common symptoms. The third one down here I really like, a different way of thinking about the world, a different way of perceiving the world. And I often look at that as two-sided. Certainly it can cause many issues, but it can also be a huge asset in problem solving and creativity and really helping us to see things differently. And another comment on terminology. So we use the term autism and autism spectrum disorder interchangeably, as do many folks in the field. Prior to 2013, there were several diagnoses that could have been diagnosed, including the famous Asperger syndrome, which I'm assuming most people have heard. But in 2013, it clumped everything into just one autism spectrum disorder. So any questions or comments about that? Okay, so prevalence trends. The CDC last week came out with their latest numbers, and it's 1 in 68 children. They've been looking at an 8-year-old sample every 2 years now since 2000. And up until the last 2 years ago, it increased every single year. This year, 1 in 68 is the first time it's stabilized. But they're being very cautious about that number. And I think they want to see a couple more years of data to see if it really has stabilized or if there are other factors, including the way they actually do the survey to find out how many children do have autism. We know it's diagnosed more in males. I'm not sure if that's what you see on campus in terms of the folks who present with autism. And the third bullet down here clearly is important for us at the Institute of Higher Education is that we know that many more have typical or above average intelligence than we did historically. Okay, when I first got in this business, I remember in the early 1990s, the figure of 75% of all people with autism had an intellectual disability. And the latest data is now it's probably south of 50% when the DSM-5 and the CDC numbers, they're showing that there are many, many more typically in terms of intelligence in the average or above average range. So obviously that has ramifications for us. Now, despite all these advances, and especially in education, my field, where we know so much more about how to best educate these children, there's still many, many questions, especially about our adult population. Very little has been done. There are so many needed research questions that need to be answered about adults with autism in college and adults past that into middle adulthood and those who are senior citizens. So that's something to keep an eye on. Any questions or comments? All right, so the next slide is a visual that Stephen Shore likes to share. He didn't create this, but now Stephen is an adult with autism. He's actually a college professor at Adelphi, and he talks about this wedge and explaining the diversity of autism in this manner, where you have severe symptomologies going up to I don't necessarily like the word light, but that's how that's termed, the idea that much more able, going to be included in general education classes, able to go to college, at least academically, very able. And you can see the different shapes to show the diversity. And as you move down and it becomes more severe, how the shapes, there's not quite as many. And the idea that that's why the autistic folks at college can look so very different even if they have the same label. Okay. All All right, so what about autism in post-secondary life? Just a few statistics. There's been several studies done recently, and we know the majority of adults with autism, actually the word unemployed should be up there. They're either unemployed, underemployed, so they're working, you know, 2 to 5, you know, very few hours a week. And then that word malemployed, they're not matched up to a job that they're going to be successful in. And more than likely, they'll quit or be fired after a very short tenure because they're just not matched up to it. It doesn't match up with their strengths, and perhaps it's a job that has more social interaction that they're able to perform. But at any rate, we know, and the numbers are very sobering for autism. I mean, it's tough for disabilities in general, as is the whole population over the last 7-8 years of what we've been going through in this country, but it's particularly hard hit for autism. In fact, youth who have intellectual disabilities, learning disabilities, and speech-language impairment, they're all employed at greater rates than are young adults with autism. And the bottom bullet point is probably the saddest to me, is that not that they're living at home, because many young adults are at home without disabilities, it's that they have limited involvement in outside activities in the community and leisure activities, and few or no close friends. And we know the protective value of having close friends and being engaged and what that means for all the comorbid diagnoses that are often associated with autism, like depression and anxiety and so forth. Okay? So besides employment, we also know that folks with ASD have lower rates of attending college, whether that's community colleges, four-year institutions, public, private, everything. So compared to students with learning disabilities and speech-language impairments. Okay? And the most uninvolved group is actually the 3 years right after high school. And I can't tell you how many times I get phone calls from parents. You know, my son just sits in the basement playing video games. We can't get him motivated. We can't get him out in the community. What do we do? Now, on the flip side, at least a positive sign is after that 3 year, 3 to 5 year gap, many are going to college or getting more involved. Still not huge numbers, but it's certainly something to be aware of. Okay. So any questions, comments about any of this? Yes,
Josh. When you say graduates, is that high school graduates?
Exactly. Yep. Okay, so prevalence numbers. I mentioned the 1 in 68 number. Now, clearly that would involve people with autism who have intellectual disability who would not be traditionally applying to college. But even if we adjust that number, you know, so how many should there be in college? Now, here's some numbers from our Disability Service Center at RIC. As of last semester, we had 41 individuals with autism registered. Okay, so roughly 2.5% of all the folks who have disabilities on campus who registered. And that was a pretty big increase from 2013. Okay. And that number is wrong if you haven't, that's probably should be about 5%. Yeah. Sorry about that. And then at the University of Rhode Island, your latest data is that you have 51 students who are registered with DSS. And 22 who are currently receiving supports and accommodations this semester. Okay, so I think most people would think those numbers are low for a number of reasons. These are only people who have actually registered or disclosed and are asking for help. You know, how many others are out there? How many know they have autism, have been diagnosed with it, but don't disclose that information? And out of those, who is successful? Who's dropping out? How many people have autism but it hasn't been diagnosed yet? And it will be diagnosed in the coming years. And we know many adults get diagnosed with autism in their 20s, 30s, or even older. Okay. So all of these have to come into play and say, how do we support those students? All right, so professionals, I mentioned the DSM-5. Clearly that's what they use in the medical field. In school, we use the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act to find students eligible for services from early intervention all the way up to age 21. But it's a little different, obviously, college. So we have the Americans with Disabilities Act, and we have the Rehab Act of 1973, the famous Section 504, which allows for reasonable accommodations for any person with a disability who qualifies. And I'm sure Pam could tell us all about all those good things. But the bottom line is, yeah, exactly. A few hours would be needed. You know, the bottom line is equal access. Okay, there can't be discrimination. People need access to not only the physical spaces, but to the curriculum, to online courses as well, and being so big of late, that's important too. And especially for our folks with autism who really appreciate online courses for all the matching up of characteristics and how well that works for them. Now, other supports, interestingly, this is really last 3 to 5 years. Programs for students with autism on campus have been sprouting up across the country. There's easily several dozen of them. And some are free and just, you know, it might be a minor kind of support, like peer mentoring, okay? Where a graduate student would pair up with someone and kind of show them the ropes, answer questions, be a buddy, that kind of thing. Or you could spend upwards of $3,000 or more a semester to pay for specific supports. Everything from, you know, assisting with daily living skills like cooking and laundry, to social skills groups, to accessing things on campus, enrolling in classes, you know, tutoring, the whole 10 yards. And it's very inconsistent, as you might imagine, from state to state and school to school, but this is definitely something that it's been blossoming. Yes?
I don't know if Pam would like to say something about what URI does along these lines.
Yeah, that'd be great, because I did read up on you guys.
We have a partnership between communicative disorders and disability services, so it involves, we're calling it communication coaching, and as of now, it doesn't cost anything, although we ask for donations to the foundation, but we are applying for a fee of like $1,500 or something along those lines. But what it involves is the graduate students in communicative disorders are the coaches to provide language therapy in the pragmatic language, like voice tone and, you know, irony and sarcasm and those kinds of social interaction skills. And then they have an undergraduate peer mentor to follow up on the goals, but on campus somewhere in like the regular student activity areas. And then there is a social group involved too, and then they meet weekly with their DSS advisor as well. So it's a pretty intensive support and in a lot of different areas. So I mean, I don't have real data to say people graduate if they go to our program, but I think that it does provide support that they wouldn't get otherwise.
So we had a question online, which just is URI specific. What are the kinds of accommodations for the classroom? Are there accommodations for a classroom with these students, and what does that look like?
Well, and again, it depends on the student. Mm-hmm. Like some students on the spectrum don't want any accommodations. They don't want their professors to know at all.
Right.
Or they might have you know, more time on task, because a lot of times it's this executive function. It looks a lot like ADHD.
Yeah.
Or like a separate space to take tests or more time to take tests. They get priority registration, maybe, but mostly it's the support outside of the classroom that ends up being kind of important, because organizing, you know, some people are great at organizing, others are really terrible. I have one student that's lost his wallet 3 times in this semester. And he rides the bus. So his bus pass, his ID card, his money for his, you know, it's just, that's really disruptive to anybody's life. But
indeed,
especially if you already have trouble organizing.
Right, right, just compounds. So that was a great question. Actually, I have a journal here that just came in my mailbox a couple days ago, and there's like 4 or 5 articles pertaining to college students and autism, and I'll pass it around. If you go online to your electronic databases, you can probably download all these for free. And then there's a table in this one article that talks about the top accommodations for students with autism in college, and it's extra time on exams, alternate testing site, note taker, technology supports, reduced course load, copy of professor's notes, life skills instruction, and then there's a few others. So I'll just pass this around so you can take a look at it, but there's several there.
You know, life skill instruction is not an ADA kind of thing. That's a personal service. So some of those are...
And some of those were from programs that they have to pay for.
Yeah,
right.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Good point. Okay, so moving right along. So what are the characteristics of autism? We've already talked about a few and related to them to some problems in the classroom and on campus. Let me just ask, so what do you think? What are some common strengths? What do you think people with autism bring to the table as strengths? Eric?
I think often you have an incredible focus on detail.
Excellent.
And just way more detail than anyone else could manage and kind of be able to access, create really rich, almost data banks, it feels like sometimes.
Yeah, yeah, so great. So attention to detail. What else?
Good intellect.
Intellect, great.
Enthusiasm for specific topics of interest.
Indeed. Anyone online want to share an answer?
Nothing yet.
Okay. Austin?
Actually, I'm Rob.
Oh, Rob, I'm sorry. I did that twice already.
We let it go the first time.
I was thinking Austin's pretty cool. Maybe I could be Austin today. I think often they provide a different perspective because they don't make assumptions that many of us make because we've been socialized in a particular way. So they'll question something that we don't just take for granted.
Yeah, excellent. Great. So that's kind of what I had written down. Clearly intellectual ability, academic skills. You got a guy who just loves history. He's going to be a great history major. I mean, he's just so into that topic and the details and different perspective and so forth, as well as others. Because it's a spectrum, you have this wide diversity of. But clearly, these are three that speak out. All right. So there's definitely some core dimensions of autism, and you can see them up here on the slide. There are certainly other things. I mentioned comorbid mental health concerns, which are often a problem, that's not up here. We've spoken about the cognitive and intellectual piece, social, communication, sensory. Jan talked about turning off the lights in her office. Clearly, we have lots of research as well as to adjust for that. And it's sometimes it's just simple stuff like turning down the lights, letting them know in advance. If you're going to be playing a video that might, you know, sometimes you turn it on, it's very abrupt and loud. Putting tennis balls underneath chairs that are on floors that would screech, things like that. I always find working with occupational therapists and physical therapists in this area to come up with good supports is really great. Restricted patterns of behavior and interest, so this could be the positive that Rob and Eric talked about. But also, we know some of them have some very significant self-stimulatory behaviors that, while you may not want to extinguish because it's meaningful to the person and it may help them calm down, if it interferes in the classroom or in social engagement in some way, then that has to be questioned. And sometimes that's difficult. Yes?
I know that some, anxiety is probably treated very often as a comorbid thing, but my experience has been that, for example, the difficulty someone in the spectrum has dealing with the sensory environment produces a lot of anxiety,
yeah,
which then starts to affect their ability to regulate and do, social interaction, and it leads to, I often wonder, how much is anxiety really separate from this, or is it really at the heart of the spectrum?
Yeah, maybe someday there'll be really fine-tuned neuroimaging and other studies that can pinpoint that and say yes. And clearly most of the individuals I've worked with have had anxiety, so you're spot on with that. Okay, I'm gonna not go into details here for a number of reasons, but if you have questions, please feel free to ask or email. The next slide, I like this slide. It's from the CDC, and it shows the different dimensions of autism and how they come on this sliding scale, almost like tuning an old-fashioned radio where, on one hand, someone with autism could have an intellectual disability, but on the other hand, they can be they can be gifted. And you can go down through each of these and show how, and you mix them up, and then you come up with, okay, this is this person's particular profile, you know, and that's important to know. Okay, so in social interaction, and I was so happy, so my guest speaker on Tuesday who has autism, the first bullet point here, he almost said word for word, and I was like, wow, that just reaffirms what I already knew and what I have in my presentation, that, you know, social learning just doesn't come easy, and it's not intuitive. It just doesn't come from picking it up like so many of us learned when we were kids and even into adulthood. It's a cognitive experience. And he said, I can learn any social skill if you teach me, if you point out my errors, and then I'm happy to change. But most of the time, I don't know what those are, and I end up doing things that get me fired or in trouble or whatever. Particular impairments in terms, we've already talked about nonverbal communication, perspective taking, understanding the hidden curriculum. So the stuff we all know, but we're never really taught. And next week, I know Sue Constable is going to talk about that. It's a really good part of her presentation. As well as seeing the big picture. So let's see. This would have been a video. We just don't have time, sadly. It would have been a video showing some nonverbal cues and how the person didn't realize how they were coming across to the other person, even though he was making all kinds of nonverbal cues. If you just, you can type in that particular URL and find it online as well.
And we'll share the slides with everyone who's registered
too. Okay, great, perfect. Now, one video I do want to show, and I'll set this up. So a few years ago, a book came out, and it was about context blindness. Autism is context blindness, and that the challenges are often associated with not getting the context. And this particular video I'm going to show, and you can start it, thank you, is from Rain Man. And I'm sure many people have seen this particular movie and this scene where Dustin Hoffman is playing an adult with autism, and Tom Cruise is his brother, who just found out he has this brother with autism. He's taking him cross country to get him help, although he has some ulterior motives, if you recall. And this is a scene where context really matters. And I'll just shut up and let you watch. Okay, you can stop it. Okay, so can someone tell us what's the purpose of that video, or what happened there? Kind of deconstruct it and how it, why it matters to autism, and then therefore why does it matter to us teaching at the college level? Okay, so Pam said it's a literal following of directions regardless of what's happening.
Oh, you want me to say more?
Unless someone else wants to jump in.
He just isn't aware of the environment. He isn't, the don't walk Kate was like top priority for him, regardless of the fact that he's going to get hit. I mean, he clearly knows how to cross the street, but in that context, don't walk into priority and interrupt it. That. So that would happen in a test situation or whatever. I mean, you know, a fire alarm or, you know, an emergency situation in a classroom, you know, I think people would get disoriented in that situation too, because they might not know what to do next, because sequential reasoning is kind of disruptive.
Yeah. So you could just come up and do the rest of this, Pam. So she's absolutely correct. He understood how to do it. He understood how to cross the street. He understood literally what the walk and don't walk meant, and he was following it. But then he's so literal, and he doesn't get the context that the hidden curriculum is, if you're halfway across the street and it says don't walk, you hightail it across the street and finish. Or you go back, either way, but you don't stand in the middle. And then what happened after the guy, what other characteristic did we see come into play?
Well, once the honking started and all this, it was like, suddenly it was an overwhelming, there was no possibility to respond, and the tension went even higher. I mean, to me, it made me think of a student who has a little response to an instruction you've given in the classroom. Faculty are notoriously vague or have all sorts of subtext built in. All of our students ask us, well, what do you mean about X, Y, and Z? But in this case, they do something, they're following it, and then we tell them, oh, you're not doing it right, and just like how that could set off a student in that setting where they think they're doing the right thing, they're really trying to follow all the literal instructions as closely as possible, and criticism in that context could essentially cause someone to freeze up and make a social situation much worse.
Got it. That's absolutely right. Good. Okay, anyone online want to make any comments? Got to give them opportunity.
Yeah.
Okay. You mentioned executive functioning earlier, Pam, and clearly this is important. So the prefrontal cortex and all of the different jobs that must take place. And if you look at these, this is part and parcel of college. I mean, working memory when you're having discussions and applying what you're learning in that setting, or being able to just plan your day and pack your backpack and bring the right materials. And how do you plan for when the assignment's due in 3 weeks? How are you gonna get that done? And I know next week that Sue is also going to be talking more about this. So moving right along. Now, we're gonna segue to Deb's part now on behavior and communication. Just wanna ask if there were any questions at this point.
Must I use the microphone?
Yeah, if you don't use the microphone, no one will hear you.
Definitely not dressed for the microphone, but we will make it work. Okay. All right, so I'm going to be shifting gears here and talking a little bit about behavioral theory. Paul's been talking about a number of the common characteristics that we see in individuals on the spectrum. But I want to take a step back and look at behavior in general, because the way that most of these deficits or characteristics manifest is in external behavior. That's where sort of the rub is. So there are three laws of behavior, and they apply to prosocial behavior, they apply to problem behavior, and everything in between. And they are that first, all behavior is learned. And that applies literally to everything save autonomic responses. Everything that we do behaviorally, we have learned, typically through modeling, watching others, trial and error. We also know that behavior has a context. So when we talk about appropriate behavior, we have to look at it in terms of, is there a match between the context and the behavior that we're seeing? So behavior that would be appropriate, let's say at a Bruins game, is not going to be the same kind of behavior that's going to be considered appropriate in a synagogue. And truly, the degree of mismatch that we see between the environment or context and the behavior that we are observing is the degree to which we call that behavior problematic. The third law of behavior is that if we're seeing a behavior repeatedly, regardless of whether that behavior is prosocial or problem, we know for certain that that behavior is of benefit to the individual. And again, true of both problem and prosocial behavior. When we think about problem behavior, it can be very difficult for us to understand what is the benefit of this behavior to the person. But if we can understand what that benefit is, how does that behavior benefit the individual, we have a very rich opportunity to reach that person and either teach them different ways to get the same needs met or change our context, change our expectations so that the way that they're getting their needs met is a better fit with what we are seeing. So when we look at these three laws, the implications are that since behavior is learned, it can be taught. Because behavior has a context, we have an opportunity to change contexts, which in turn changes behavior. And finally, because repeated behavior serves a purpose, it can be replaced. So again, understanding the purpose or function of a behavior enables us to say, okay, so I get that you don't want to do this assignment. But right now, the way that you're showing me you don't want to do that assignment is by walking out of class. How about we set up another way for you to communicate to me, I don't want to do this assignment, but then maybe I can help you. You can get the work done and stay in the class. So we want to look at function or purpose of behavior as sort of the end point and work backwards. What's an appropriate way for that individual to get that need met? Because that need is not going to change. That need is fairly static. So what we know about behavior is that everything that we do serves one of two purposes, to either obtain something or avoid something. And there are basically three things that fall into the category of what we can obtain or avoid. And it's typically attention, that's the most common function. And attention can be from adults or peers. And as students get older, they tend to shift their desired focus of receipt of attention from adults to peers. Students also engage in both prosocial and problem behavior in order to get or escape a tangible or an activity, or engage in behavior to obtain or avoid sensory stimulation. So consider what this means for communication. When students are engaging in challenging behavior, the question becomes, what are they trying to avoid? Or what are they trying to obtain? Rather than what the heck is going on here, try to take a step back and understand that what you're seeing is a behavioral deficit. This is an individual that has a need, and they are expressing it in the way that they have learned works. Okay? So I'm going to show you the behavior pathway, and some of you may be familiar with this, but the behavior pathway is essentially a graphical representation of those three laws of behavior. We know that there are events that precede behavior, and collectively we call those antecedents. And we know that there are what we call maintaining events, also known as consequences, that come after behavior. And this pathway applies to both prosocial behavior and problem behavior. So let me show you an example starting with the prosocial behavior. So here the setting event is professor's teaching a lesson. Okay? Student is asked to demonstrate understanding by taking an exam. Student works very hard on the exam, obtains an excellent grade. Maintaining event is long term, I graduate, short term, boy, I passed that class. Or even I got through that week. Okay? So the function, and again, we're talking about this behavior in the center here. The purpose of that behavior is to obtain, again, long-term diploma, short-term school success. But understand that absent being appropriately taught that lesson, Absent the student understanding the content and given an appropriate way to demonstrate that understanding, this behavior does not happen. Okay? So this is just an example of how it applies to prosocial behavior. Here's an example of how it applies to problem behavior. Same pathway, same theoretical understanding. Again, events that precede. So in this example, we have an individual who, before they walk into your class, had an argument with his girlfriend. Okay? Hour beforehand, argument, getting ready to walk into your class. Comes in, and one of the tasks that they're asked to do is to engage in a group project. Okay? Here the student has a tantrum. And that tantrum, I'm using that term very, very broadly, but essentially the message is leave me alone. It may be the student shuts down, refuses to participate. It may be that you see more externalizing behavior. This is stupid, I don't want to do this. And so ultimately the outcome of that behavior for this student in this situation is they're able to work alone. Because honestly, what the instructor wants is demonstration of knowledge. Ideally, we're going to do it within the context of this group, but in this case, student's not able to do it, so let's let them do it alone. And the function here, again, the function or purpose of this behavior in this case was to avoid peers or avoid the social demands that are associated with interacting with other students in a group project. Okay? So any questions about this? All right. So what I'd like to do is go through each of the parts of that pathway, talk about what types of things we see in typical college environments that set up students for either the kind of behavior that we want to see, the kind of behavior that leads to academic and social success, and what kinds of events or outcomes make it more likely that we're going to see problem behavior. And realistically, we're talking about probabilities here. There are very few alwayses. It's what is most likely to make a behavior more or less likely to occur. So let's start out with setting events. And if that one handout can, actually, both handouts can go out right now. So I've got a couple of handouts. One is just a quick one-pager that talks a little bit about some of the common setting events, some of the common triggering events, and some of the common maintaining events that are found in college classrooms. The other is a sheet that I'm going to ask you to do as we go through this, just to sort of think about what are the setting events, triggering events, and maintaining events or consequences that might take place in your classroom that make problem or prosocial behavior more likely. So let's start, if you will, with setting events. Setting events might be student-related, so they may be things like an individual has a skill deficit or a basic lack of understanding. They may be personal. So personal might be things like I'm on a medication that makes me tired, or I didn't sleep well last night, or I'm hungry, I didn't have a chance to eat. Okay. Typically though, when we're talking about setting events in college, we're talking, and setting events that we can change, we're talking about contexts. Think about the classrooms that you teach in. Okay. I've taught in a lot of classrooms, and I had a horrible classroom one year. I had one of those science labs where the seats are tiered, and they're very narrow, and the desks, these little mini that look like airplane trays, kind of popped up and shifted over. And a lot of the content that I presented was stuff that I wanted them to do in groups, to process in groups. And it made it almost impossible. The way that classroom was set up made it impossible for that type of interaction to happen. That was problematic. So that's an example of how the environment itself made certain tasks either easier or less easy, okay? As context changes, behavioral demands change. Okay, context can also be everything from the room is too hot or the room is too cold. Context also has to do with the expectations that instructors, professors have of their students, okay? Depending upon the subject you teach, the level at which you teach, are you teaching introductory courses, are you teaching advanced graduate courses? Depending upon your own comfort with student problem behavior, you may have some very strict expectations for what students are to do in your class. The degree to which those are clear to students is a setting event. And go back to some of the things that Paul had talked about, some of the characteristics that in and of itself, the student is walking into your room with a deficit in the ability to understand what is expected. So the clearer and more concrete, really operationally concretize what your expectations are. If you expect students to not use technology, not get use their cell phones during class, make that explicit. Make your behavioral expectations very explicit. That will help students who have these types of deficits. They will also be helpful for all of your students. Plus, they give you a leg to stand on if somebody comes back, if you have to say, you know, you're on your cell phone a lot. Well, here's the expectation. It's laid out very clearly. You're not meeting it. Here we go. So that can benefit both students on the spectrum and those without. And setting events, whether they exist in terms of what our expectations are, whether they exist in terms of what student skill levels are, or whether they exist as a function of the context or environment, set the stage. They make a behavior more likely. Okay? So some of the setting events that we often see that lead to problem behavior, that make it more likely in college classrooms, the first are really student related. So oftentimes we see low or lagging academic skills, but as Paul pointed out, often we have students on the spectrum who are quite gifted academically. Paul talked about the social communication deficits, attention deficits, organizational deficits, as well as oftentimes the concomitant mental health issues that we see. Okay. Also, a setting event is past school success. If you have a student who has had challenges in their classrooms, who have experienced course failures, it becomes that much harder. That becomes a setting event. Oh, what's going to happen now? Okay. So there may also be peers that they get along with who are not in class one day, or their group partner is absent one day. Okay. Environmental related. The supports may not match students' need. Now, we talked about students who self-identify to disability services. A lot of students who have these kinds of behavioral characteristics do not self-identify. Some students may need a lot of visual supports. When the supports that we provide, when the methods that we teach don't match student need, okay, it's a contextual related setting event. There might be loose structure. I've both taken and seen courses being taught where there's a lack of predictability, and that may be a function of the course content. It may be this is going to evolve over the course of the semester, so there is a lack of predictability, but that lack of predictability can be very problematic for some students. Okay? And unclear expectations. Some people are very skilled at communicating clearly what their expectations are. Others struggle. And sometimes I think when we were talking about this earlier, we assume a contextual knowledge. We assume that students who walk in have a certain background, a common knowledge. There may be gaps, especially in students that may have these types of challenges. So to us, what may seem as pretty much, well, of course, that's the way it's supposed to be, to these particular students, they may not have that aha background. Okay? So to them, expectations are in fact unclear. Any questions about that?
I can imagine that there's a risk in setting very clear expectations that the student then doesn't meet those expectations and then kind of melts down as a result of that.
Mm-hmm. I think there's a difference between very clear and very high. You may have an expectation, I expect students to get their homework in on time. Okay. If that's stated clearly and that's the expectation, I think that's absolutely fine. I'm not sure how would that be overly explicit, something like that.
Well, if the expectation is I expect students to get their homework in on time, but then this student isn't able to get their homework in on time,
mm-hmm,
because of other reasons, and therefore you know, can't meet that.
Mm-hmm.
Then you're in the situation where laid out a clear expectation, the student can't meet it, and mm-hmm, then is there a risk of that kind of, you know, catapult?
Yes.
I mean, with a different kind of breakdown of students, I've seen that students who come from more, let's say, socially privileged backgrounds routinely ask for, something happens in their life, and it's not unreasonable, you know, a family member dies or something happens, they're prepared to ask for an extension, even though it was laid out clearly, and just see what happens. Whereas the student who might come from a family they're a first generation college student, I've seen them have horrible things happen in their life that any faculty member would absolutely bend over backwards, and they don't even mention that this has happened. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if that's kind of what you're thinking, Austin, that you've laid out these clear rules and some students might not connect with you as a result because they feel like, oh, I didn't meet those expectations, I shouldn't go talk to the professor about that.
In the context of students on the spectrum, right. I know very little about this, so, and I guess my question is there a risk of setting an expectation, having the expectation not be able to be met by that student, mm-hmm. and then having that become an even bigger issue because the expectation was so rigid and so clear, mm-hmm. and then they couldn't meet that expectation, and then having this sense of failure. Because mm-hmm. they didn't meet that expectation.
One of the expectations I always lay out for my students is that students are expected to communicate with the instructor if they have any issues or any concerns or are unable to meet deadlines, timelines, or require extra help. And I lay that out very clearly. I give them my cell phone number. I encourage them to text me if they want to talk. They don't have to do it face-to-face necessarily, but I welcome them to talk to me and actually make that an expectation. You are expected, and I say failure to communicate with the instructor does not excuse the student from any or all requirements. And I think if you make it clear that you welcome that communication and that you expect it, I think that enables you to at least, in some ways, guard against that happening. Yes?
I think when we're talking about people on the spectrum, it's the opposite, that our expectations often include a great deal that we just expect because we're more socialized. So an example that I ran into one time as a student who was on the spectrum was told during a January term course when they're asking about the grading, the person said, well, I expect everyone to do really well in this course. And what the professor was really saying is, it's an easy course, it's January. And the student totally freaked out because they thought, oh, they have really high expectations because they expect everybody to do really well in the course. And I think one of the problems that we have, and it kind of, I think, goes back to your walk, no walk also, is we don't say what we mean so much of the time.
There's so many idioms in
and we don't
language.
Follow the rules mm-hmm. almost all the time. Mm-hmm. And so giving these type of clear expectations at times requires us to violate the way we actually behave as neurotypicals, because we all know what we're really talking about when we talk about some of these things. Mm-hmm. So I think that's the problem you need to think about is, are you laying out all the things that go unsaid? And sometimes that causes us to actually mean, oh, do we really always charge, give someone 10% off if they get it in late? Or do I actually listen to the excuses afterwards? And I think we tend to find out that our rules aren't really what we do.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Is that a function, though, of our flexibility and our willingness to help all students to succeed?
Sure, because we want to, yeah, absolutely, that's right. But it's also the way we behave. None of us followed the speed limit if we drove here today. None of us did.
Right.
So we kind of all know what we can do, what we can get away with.
But the consequences for not following the speed limit are remote for the vast majority of us, the vast majority of time. There are no consequences.
Well, actually, it depends who you are
around
here.
Is that right?
I said about that. There is profiling of all sorts that goes on. But still, South King's stat officer was quoted in the paper, well, at the beginning of the semester when the students come in, we strictly enforce the speed limit, which means if you do about 33, you'll get a ticket, even though it says 25, so you're even qualifying it. But, I mean, I think what I'm saying is that I have very clear expectations about getting things on time because I really want them to be prepared for work. And if you get your things in late, you know, not on a deadline, it's a real problem for work. On the other hand, if you were at work and something comes up, you would then go and talk to people about it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think what you're saying, someone's saying about, well, I guess for you. I think maybe putting into the syllabus something about if there are really good reasons for not being able to meet this expectation,
mm-hmm.
you need to talk about these beforehand and so
mm-hmm.
forth. To build in the idea that there's always got to be flexibilities for, well, context. We don't know what the context is going to be.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you. I think having that in there, my only caution would be good reason is open to interpretation. The student might think it's a really good reason that I got drunk last night and I couldn't get up this morning, so my assignment is late. That to the student is a good reason.
I personally know I got drunk last night. But I think that's true.
Yeah.
But that's part of interpretation within a social context. And so I mean, it's just a really slow way to have any type of conversation. And maybe one thing is it makes everyone autistic because you can't pick up on all these types of social cues that we're used to picking
mm-hmm.
up in conversation.
Mm-hmm.
I'm shocked that you're giving them your cell phone number.
I have not, to be honest with you, I have not had yet a problem with it.
Yeah.
Students have been very, very respectful. And I put that as an expectation.
I mean, one thing I'm starting to think about doing in my small classes is require a meeting at the beginning of the semester just to talk things over with all students.
One-on-one,
because they are getting
mm-hmm.
less and less willing to come to your office hours.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, across it. And I think that would be a great time with dealing with kids on the spectrum to see how they're understanding the type of instructions you're giving.
Mm-hmm.
And so that could be time when you might talk also about
yes.
how things can be adjusted.
Yes, I did see your hand up.
Well, I was just going to say that for students on the spectrum or any student with a disability, you can assume at least at URI or other, you know, selected institutions that these students have qualified academically to be here. And students on the spectrum are students like any other student. And do things like any other student, and so good reason or not. I mean, I think you can hold people to the same expectation or similar with flexibility as any other
mm-hmm.
student.
I think it's true if you make expectations very clear
right.
and concrete, very observable.
Mm-hmm.
The less open to interpretation, I think, the stronger ground that,
right.
that you're on. But in the interest of time, I'm going to go ahead and move along. One of the handouts that you got is a sheet that asks you to just think about the kinds of setting events that might be existing in your classroom. So think about the kinds of students. Are you teaching graduate students or first-year undergrads? Because that's going to make a difference in their social maturity as well as their academic background. What subject do you teach? Do you teach a subject that involves a lot of group activities, or is it a lot of just straight lecture? How is your class structured? So what are the physical arrangements? When we came in here, the tables were set up differently, and the suggestion was made, let's put them in groups because that facilitates group discussion. So that's a good example of we changed the structure in order to facilitate the tasks that we wanted you all to engage in. So think about those setting events that exist, and later on, let's take a look at what are some strategies that you might use to decrease the impact of those on students who do have autism spectrum disorders. So the second part of our pathway, and another antecedent, is triggering events. This is one of my favorite cartoons. Okay, who's ready for some bickering? Okay, so the triggering event here is the turkey hits the table and Dad picks up the carving knife. So the thing about trigger events is they occur typically right before the behavior. Oftentimes they involve a demand, a task demand to do or think about something, okay? So there is a presentation of task demands, and we all know that you can present the same task demand in 5 or 6 or 20 different ways. And depending upon how it's presented, the response you get may change. Okay? So a presentation of a task demand in and of itself is not bad, but how it is being presented may or may not make the difference between is this a triggering event for this student or not. Okay? Trigger events typically exist within the same context of the behavior. So who is around? When is it? Okay? Where is that task demand issued? And the thing to understand about triggering events is they combine with setting events to make behavior more likely. So consider a case of a student who may have a social deficit. They shy away from group work because their experience has been, when I try to work in groups, I just get frustrated, I get anxious, and everybody else seems annoyed with me. So that's a setting event that they walk into your class with. If you never ask them to interact in a group setting, no problem. You're not going to see a problem behavior. There is no combination. If they don't have that deficit and you ask them to interact in groups, no problem. But when you combine the existence of that skill deficit with the demand to use that skill, that's when we see problem behavior. Okay? So it's not just the nature of the task demands. It's how the task demands are presented and how do those task demands combine with any setting events that are in place, be they a part of the context or be they something the student walks into your classroom with. How do those things combine? Events that can trigger problem behavior in classrooms, college classrooms, difficult tasks, exams, and as you can see going down this list, this is not just students on the spectrum, but particularly for students on the spectrum. Competing deadlines are very difficult for students on the spectrum to deal with organizationally in general, but also time demands can be very anxiety provoking for individuals on the spectrum because sometimes they do get so bogged down in details, they fail to see the larger picture of the entire assignment. Students may not know how to ask for help. They may not know where to go for help. They may not have a clear understanding of due dates, demands for group tasks, demands for quiet listening. Okay, you may have a student, somebody referred to a student earlier that asked question after question after question. If the expectation is, okay, I'm going to talk a little bit, or this other student is going to present a project, and the expectation is that nobody asks questions, that student continually interrupting to ask questions is problem behavior, okay? Downtime can be very difficult for some students, and multi-step directions can be very difficult for some students. So thinking about triggering events in your classroom, okay? What do you ask of students, both in your class and outside of class? Okay, what is the nature of the task? Is it group tasks? Is it individual tasks? Okay. How are instructions presented? Ideally, when you give an instruction, if you can present it both orally and in written form, that can be of huge benefit. Or if you guys use electronic management learning systems, we use Blackboard. I don't know if you use Blackboard or something similar.
Similar.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, even putting assignments very clearly with specifically laid out steps that are bulleted can be very useful to have that accessible to students, okay? Using technology. Yes, I agree with you, emails, communicating with students, you take that away, but for students on the spectrum, that may be exactly the thing that is getting in the way of their being able to communicate effectively with you. So offering them that option can be very useful. You can submit assignments just online, or you can come to class and hand them in, okay? So think about the kinds of triggering events that may exist in your classroom, and again, you may want to note a few on that sheet, and these are just for your consideration, okay? To think about, are these things that I can or would be motivated to maybe take a look at and doing a little bit differently, okay? The third part of our pathway are what we call maintaining events, and oftentimes those are referred to as consequences, but consequences has a negative term, okay? Think of consequences in this far as just sort of the outcome. So I do something and there is an outcome. It occurs consistently after the behavior, so I do something once, it's a bad outcome. For me, eating kiwi fruit has a very bad outcome. I wind up in the hospital. I don't eat kiwi fruit, because I've associated that horrible outcome with that behavior of eating kiwi fruit. On the other hand, dark chocolate results in very different behavior, okay? Very different outcome Love it, love it. Pleasurable experience. Going to eat dark chocolate more. Okay? So look at what comes after the behavior, because that outcome is what cements learning. Oh, I did this, and this happened. Oh, I like that. I'm going to do that thing again. Okay? Or I didn't do this particular thing. Okay, I didn't eat 4 slices of pizza at midnight, so I'm going to wake up in the morning and I'm going to feel okay. Okay? Yes.
I kind of think of some of the most extreme, not the most extreme, but some extreme examples of negative behavior in a classroom and the way I've responded, I think being a pretty negative consequence for students. So a student watching a video in the back of a large lecture classroom and getting called out in front of everyone is not nice for that student. Now, I don't think that's a maintaining event, because I think some student might have be terrified from that experience and then not come to class anymore, mm-hmm. right? So it could have, I don't know how that fits into this, where they're, because I think that's likely to happen for faculty when they encounter some of these behaviors. The student who asks lots of questions and then the faculty member snaps at them, that's probably not going to be a maintaining event for someone in the spectrum. In fact, it might produce some, like, not coming to class anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know how that figures into, when we think about supporting these students, is it more likely that they really get these maintaining events, or are they encountering lots of experiences where things that could have been, could have become a pro-social thing get turned negative and mm-hmm. kind of turn them away from the learning experience? I don't know if it's clear.
No, I understand what you're saying. I think we need to look at what is our goal in responding to student problem behavior. Is our goal to simply stop the problem behavior, or is our goal to maybe take that extra step and change that behavior a little bit? Okay, I love to use proximity control in my classrooms. So if I see a student who is watching a video, I will just go stand next to them. I will not say a thing. I will not make eye contact with them. I will not reference it at all. But I want them to know, yes, we agree that what you're doing is wrong, and you know you're not supposed to be doing what you're doing. And the goal, hopefully, is to give the student the message in a private way that we both agree this is not okay. You still communicate the same, but in a very different way, and it's likely to result in a different experience. You may have actually improved your relationship with the student by demonstrating that level of respect for them and that privacy.
But I think that's difficult to do with people who don't understand social cues. You know, you standing next to them doesn't say anything to them. And so I would think that, I mean, I use that behavior too, but I don't know that we have several students that I would characterize as on the autism spectrum in engineering, and they don't necessarily get those subtle cues.
Mm-hmm. You're absolutely right, and in that case, I think it warrants a private discussion after class. So you might try that sort of lower level redirection, mm-hmm. and if you're noticing they're not getting it, and maybe the student has self-identified, maybe they have not, but having a private conversation, just very brief with that student afterward. And again, if you've established the expectation up front that electronic devices are to be used to access class materials only, you can, this was going on, it's clear that that's not okay. And I think dealing with it that way. But start with the lower level intervention and then go from there. See if that has the impact that you want it to have.
I'm not sure I'm understanding. So
yes.
Really, isn't it a case of they're focused on the wrong maintaining event and you're trying to redirect them to the proper maintaining event? And that maintaining event is there, I'm enjoying watching this video, and really you want them to focus on what's going to happen in the longer term with their grade and their ability to achieve, so
you're trying to displace it. You have different goals. The student has a goal of watching the video, you have the goal of teaching the student. If the student doesn't want to be taught, as we all know, there's very little you can do to make a student want to learn. I still think we need to be very clear about what's appropriate behavior in our classrooms. And maybe if you're finding that behavior is not changing over time, a conversation about, is this really what you want to be doing, I think is a worthwhile conversation. But how we respond to problem behavior can either really damage or improve a relationship with a student. And we know that when there is a good relationship there, the student is more likely to come to class, is more likely to learn, and so forth.
So to put it differently, isn't part of your mentoring duty to point out to the student, I mean, to use my own language, that their priorities are messed up. And so replacing one priority with the bigger picture is replacing one maintaining bed with a different maintaining.
We probably can't change their priorities. I honestly believe pointing out to them. Okay, and that's fine. I think if we say, if your priority is to graduate, here's what you need to do that, and here's what I'm seeing. Okay, the student may go, oh, gosh, that's right. I'm putting at risk my academic career. But as far as changing their priorities, I honestly don't think that is something that is within our realm of responsibility. I think within our realm of responsibility as educators, it's to point out the impact of somebody's behavior on the goals. Okay? Because of this, you are not going to get to the point where you're going to pass this class, for example. Okay? I think pointing that out is fine. But then the student can say, no, I don't really care about passing your class. And I don't think we can change that.
Well, I guess what I'm saying is you're pointing out to them that then they aren't going to get the internship and then they're not going to get the job and so forth.
Right.
Okay, so you should go on.
Okay. Students will learn what to expect when they do or do not engage in a certain behavior. If you make it clear, I expect you to hand in your assignment on time, I expect you to do X, Y, and Z, or you will not succeed in this class, if you've made that clear, and they don't do it, they're going to learn fairly quickly. Well, I guess he was serious. Guess I should have done it. What do I want to do next? Okay. So some of the things that enable students or maintain problem behavior in students is if we allow them to escape difficult tasks. Okay. If we allow them to have deadlines adjusted. In some cases, these accommodations are absolutely necessary for student success. And they're completely appropriate. It's about how the student does it. Okay? Does a student come to you ahead of time and say, I've got this thing going on, or I find it really hard to concentrate in this classroom, can I do this assignment or take this test somewhere else? That's fine. But sometimes students will express the need for these accommodations in very inappropriate ways. And if they have not self-identified, it becomes very difficult for us to support them appropriately. Okay? Sometimes they obtain or escape peer attention or attention from adults. Have you ever had students that sit in the back and kind of when you say anybody would like to volunteer, you see them physically shrink down? Okay, I'm going to avoid attention by not making eye contact. I'm going to just do this. Okay, or obtain or avoid sensory feedback. Okay, some students will engage in behavior that to us seems problematic in order to, and Paul referenced this, to maintain attention or to support self-regulation. Okay. So again, something to think about for the future. How do you respond when students engage in problem behavior in your classroom? Okay. How does your response enable them to gain or avoid what they are seeking to gain or avoid? How do other students in the class respond? Okay. How are requests for changes and deadlines or tasks handled? And how are requests for tasks handled? And most educators that I know handle these beautifully and are not problematic. There are some that are very rigid, and there just needs to be an understanding that if a student comes to you and requests for a change in a deadline, how we respond to that increases or decreases the likelihood the student is going to get that task in on time, per that agreed upon change deadline. Okay. Yeah.
This is a very specific example, but student comes and there's an oral presentation required for the course where they have to stand in front of the entire class. I think I've experienced this at least a couple times with students in the spectrum, and that is they're desperate to find any other thing than to do that. Do you have kind of recommendations on how to manage that?
I had that happen once, and I had the student videotape themselves mm-hmm. giving the presentation at home, and they showed the videotape.
In class time.
They still had to answer questions, but for them, it was not a function of, can I demonstrate my knowledge? It's, can I demonstrate my knowledge this way? And for the student, they just really couldn't. You know, there was a question about whether or not ultimately being a teacher was a good choice for somebody that had that particular concern. But that was a different conversation. So yeah, I think we can be flexible with how students demonstrate their knowledge if they ask for those kinds of things, because we don't want how they're being asked to demonstrate it interfere with their ability to actually demonstrate it when they in fact know it.
So the flip side I had of that was the student who, rather than coming to talk to me about it, just didn't show up and didn't do, you know, any of that portion of the course,
mm-hmm.
everything. So they were prepared to give up 20% of their course grade rather than do that and never talk to me about it.
I do, again, at the first class, I say to students, I know some people don't like to be called on in class. Some people feel uncomfortable sharing. If that's the case, please come to me and I will not call on you. If there is a presentation, I will say at the very beginning, if doing presentations is a concern for you, please come talk to me. We'll see what we can work out. So I think putting that out there that, yes, I'm willing to be flexible about these things can be very helpful and reassuring to students. Any questions? And I know we're getting close to the end of our time. Okay. So one of the things that I'd like you to leave here with is just thinking about what are some very small changes that I could make in my classroom, or the way that I present task demands, or how my class is set up, or the way that I allow students to demonstrate knowledge. What are some very small changes that I may be able to make that would make problem behavior less likely and make it more likely that students could succeed with the tasks that we're asking them to do? So consider what this might look like. So maybe presenting task demands in a number of different ways, putting them electronically, handing them out, putting them up on the board, and presenting them orally can be very helpful for some students. So think about what it would look like to make those changes and what specifically would you need in terms of resources, and it may be none. You may be able to work with what you have. What would you need to make those changes? Maybe it's just a change in your syllabus. Putting behavioral expectations clearly delineated in your syllabus can be extremely helpful from day one. Okay, so what questions do you have at this point?
So I think this is a question.
But I don't want to take away from
Well, no, not well, at all, please.
I guess my question is with respect to resources for graduate students who are on the spectrum, so getting away from what's going on in the classroom to students that maybe we're advising and we're having a different kind of interaction with over a longer period of time, and if there's any sort of specific ways that that situation can be approached.
And I know that there are resources that your department probably has. I like to just say to a student, what works best for you? What works best? Is it best if we meet face-to-face? Is it better that we communicate through you? And I understand what you're asking, but sometimes putting it back on the student sort of takes the onus off of us to get it right. By the time students are in graduate school, I would think that they're very well aware of what their strengths are, of what supports benefit them. And I think just putting that right out there on the table is a very respectful way to meet their needs.
And I think that's true of any kind of disability, whether it's physical,
yes.
mental health. I mean, you ask them what do you need, and then let them kind of guide you. You don't assume.
But what if they're less aware?
Yeah.
I guess thinking about real situations where you might be working with a graduate student who might be less aware or less, perhaps just less sharing with you. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Where you might have a assumption about it, but you don't want to.
Yeah, we can't cross that line of sort of informally diving. You know, we don't want to go there. If they're not very aware of it, sometimes offering like one of two choices: would you prefer me to email this to you, or do you want to have a face-to-face conversation?
Okay. I guess I'm thinking for like you might have an established relationship with someone, and it's gone on for a while now, but you're like, there's really something's happening here, and you want to. Or they might have come out and said, yes, I'm on spectrum, mm-hmm. but they might not be working within that framework of, hey, I need these things to happen. How are we gonna make those things
is it impacting their success, or is it just that their yeah. interaction is, yeah, is that making us uncomfortable?
No, it is impacting their success.
Yeah.
But they're not responding.
Can I just put in a plug
please.
For disability services offices sure. at Absolutely. The universities, Brenda from CCRI or I mean, where some of the, like, we can help faculty figure out alternate ways mm. to evaluate, so you're evaluating the knowledge, not the disability. Mm. We can help with that. And we can help come up, like, we can brainstorm. If you call, we can help you brainstorm some different ideas about how to make that person's experience more successful. Because we are educators. We know about the curriculum and academic integrity and requirements. But we also know about the disability. And so we can help at least find you resources. Mm-hmm. So. I would just say online ebook at your institution, and at RIC, they're really good at RIC too. So I think there's a lot of resources at the universities for faculty.
Mm-hmm. Eric, did you have a question?
I don't know if this is the same thing, but I've heard faculty, particularly in some of our professional programs where students graduate and then need to complete some kind of certification, then having this experience where they're questioning, oh, there's a student, there's things, they can make it through our curriculum with the accommodations we give them, but I just don't feel they're able to meet this thing that happens beyond that world, that thing. And they feel like they should be giving them some sort of guidance or advice or trying to help them get on a path. And I don't know if that's the right framework, but I just kind of give voice to, I've heard people kind of describe that, and I think they're looking for advice about how should they interact with that student as their advisor or as a department thinking about what, how are they really serving the interests of a student who's gone through their program? Mm-hmm.
Can I comment?
Yes, please.
We have a lot of professional, very typical, short-term programs, and so obviously you run into that. The conversation is on the table now is to begin doing what the faculty and the department is feeling is a little bit more intense orientation. Mm-hmm. And so when you're having students coming in and being more clear about the expectations in the field. Mm-hmm. And so, and before a student gets all the way through a program and then just feeling, I don't know if they're gonna be able to do the job. Can we start at the beginning when they can have a better sense and maybe that conversation is a little bit easier? Mm-hmm. Say in those first introductory level classes, are you sure this is going to work? Because that is a faculty's position in those particular roles. It's not history or psych. You know, I wouldn't be talking about your career so much in that area. And those programs. So that's what we're hoping to do because, yes, we have students that are ready to graduate, but can they do the work?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's a great strategy. Thank you.
Yeah. You know, college's learning management system is often cited as a useful place for students to make, for teachers to make accommodations for students, even if it's not used as the main landing place for their content. But I'd be interested to hear from you guys, what are some of the common mistakes you see instructors make that can trigger students that are sensitive to the way content is presented or organized within the digital, you know, you spoke about the physical classroom space mm-hmm. and the environment, but now so much content is delivered online. What are some things that we can be looking out for to make sure we're not adding extra noise or providing that sort of thing?
Any thoughts on that, Paul? I think it is a good question.
The organization piece.
Organization
is
visually.
Yes.
You know, if there's not too much on any given link or page, the directions are very clear. Mm-hmm. Some people with autism talk about how different colors are problematic. So using very neutral colors, black ink. I'm gonna have to think about that one a little more. So it's a really good question. Maybe, I mean, certainly if you've got discussion boards as part of the you know, requirements of a course, how is that gonna impact someone who, you know, has some issues with that particular mode? You know, thinking of the tests and quizzes we give on Blackboard, you know, is it intuitive? Is it easy to figure out, you know, is everything explicit in terms of directions?
All right,
that's
a
start.
It's a good question.
Next research paper.
There you go. Any other questions? Well, thank you so much for your attention. Here's our email addresses. If you would like to reach us, feel free. We're happy to answer any questions or talk about general or specific issues that might have come up for you all. So thank you very much.
And I think the content is so perfectly shown that one of the things when we were at kind of publicizing this for faculty, that a lot of these tools to help support students in the spectrum are exactly what will benefit all students. Yes. So as we were going over so many of these behavior issues, I mean, we see them with all of our students, yes, not just students with disabilities. So yeah, it was great. Thank you.
Pleasure.
Yes. Yeah.